because I don't think it's fair for those that they came on time to wait for the others that they will be late. Now, why they are delayed is because first, if they are newcomers to our conferences, they assume that this is Athens, Greece, and everything runs late. So they have discounted it. And they say we're going to go half an hour late, because we're not going to start on time anyway. That's one thing. The second thing that I think is more important is that yesterday we had a change to move from the winter time to summer time. So we might have some people coming 1 hour late if they didn't adjust their watch. But I think it's the first reason, because even if we don't have time changes, still they are late. Now, my name is Gregory Papanikos. I'm the president of this, what we call, World Association of Academics and Researchers. Our idea, very few people, unfortunately or fortunately, very few people read our mission and our policy, and then they are not prepared for this conference mandate at least. What we do is we're trying, like in ancient Athens, to organize small events like symposiums, 25 to 50 people, in different subjects, so people from all over the world, they can come to Athens and exchange ideas. The least that you can do is, of course, prepare and present your paper for 15 minutes. But that's not sufficient, though. If you just present and you leave, you miss the whole idea of a symposium, the whole idea of exchanging views about different issues that either inside, you can do that inside this room or outside the room. Now, let me say a few words. I have prepared some notes, but that's not important. I'm a Japanese cook. I prepare the food in front of you. But I still have some notes and some pictures to show you what we are doing. First, we call ourselves an institute, but this is a misnomer. We are actually an association. We are a World Association of Academics and Researchers, and we were established in 1995 in Canada, Toronto, believe it or not. We state that in our history. And the idea comes from ancient Athens, and comes actually from Thucydides. Pericles, nobody, as I say many times, I'm an economist by trade, so I'm an amateur historian, so I have to be very careful when I say something about history. But anyway, at least I dare, because some people, they are completely ignorant of history, and still, they explain everything in historical terms. Now, that's Pericles, of course, it's a painter of the 19th century, a German painter, but I like this picture. He's Pericles, that he was like modern times Trump, Donald Trump. He was a very populist, no, I'm not kidding, actually, and my source is Pluto. And he was lying, he was spreading fake news, he was spending money so he can be re-elected. What else do you want? And now, that's one of his main speeches, I guess, in front of the Athenian public. But Thucydides, the historian, made him great, because he liked him, and he wrote the Peloponnesian War, and the most important is the one, he actually, I think, he has Pericles saying one or two or three, I think, speeches inside the Peloponnesian War, and of course, the most important one is Pericles' funeral oration to honor the first death of the Peloponnesian War. By the way, the Peloponnesian War was a civil war. It was not a heroic war, it was a war between Greeks. And Thucydides wrote that, and he was claiming, I'm not sure if it's true or not, he was claimed that our city, that Athens, is open to the world. So everybody can come and see and learn. Which I think, not so much the 5th century, but definitely the end of the 5th century after Pericles, and the entire 4th century in Athens, maybe it was true. When people like Aristotle, for example, that he was coming from Macedonia, and so many other scholars, that they would come to Athens and establish schools of thought. And that's our idea. At Atiner, what we want to do is to revive this idea of having different small schools in Athens, and so people can come from all over the world, no matter if they are Greeks or barbarians, as they call it, and they can come to Athens and exchange ideas. And I think, judging from our 30 years of success, whatever that means to measure success, of course, we're doing very well, because so far we have brought to Athens every year about 2,000 people in little small symposiums, 25 to 50 people, and in various subjects. So, and still there's a lot of room to improve. So our city is open to the world, in other words. Now, what I like to cite sometimes is, and this is very difficult, and relates very much to this conference. This conference started 12 years ago, and our idea, someone told me that Mediterranean is in turmoil. Now it's even worse. I have a year it becomes worse. And a lot of people that were very, 10 years ago, they thought there was a movement in the European Union that the Mediterranean, if we bring academics together, things will become better. I don't know if you can relate the conference with what happens right now in the Mediterranean, but once we started the conference, or Mediterranean started, things get worse. Even though we bring academics from all over the Mediterranean and outside it, things do not improve. In any case, you need to have a different culture. What made Athens very important is that they had a different culture. It was a different approach, if you want. And this was recognized by the Athenians themselves. And they mentioned that there is Xenophon of the 5th century, writing about the Athenian constitution. They said that even though the Greeks, they have the same dialect, lifestyle, and dresses, but the Athenians have an amalgam of all Greeks and barbarians. The translation from the original text is mine. Good or bad, others will judge it. But I think it reflects what the ancient Athens was. They didn't believe in one culture. That's my interpretation. They believed that there are some good. They were eclectic. They believe that people—they have races, if you want—they have something good that a smart race like the Athenians they can pick it and adopt. So it's an amalgam of all Greeks and whatever. And who is Greek? That's I like this. I like this definition. This comes from Isocrates. And because Greeks are not determined by blood. Not determined by birth, it's determined by education. So all the educated people are Greeks. So welcome to your homeland, because I assume that you are educated, you have some education. So the difference between Greeks and non-Greeks, and people don't know, Greeks and barbarians, the reason, the difference has nothing to do with blood, has nothing to do with race, even though some people's historical opinions, they try to exploit that. It has to do with education, or if you want, with pedagogy, which is a combination of education and what I call agogy. It's how you've been brought up, what principles. This is very important, and was very important. Anyway, debate. So what we are doing, I already mentioned, we have two big schools in Athens. They are in downtown Athens. You can see them. Of course, there are no remnants of that, but the space still is preserved. One was Plato's Academy, and the other was Aristotle's Lyceum. And what we are trying to do here at Atiner is mainly one day we can revive these schools, but the idea is here. The idea is to bring people from all over the world, and I think we succeeded. Now, some facts we have. Today we have 2,395 members coming from 115 countries. We're organized into 37 units, 7 divisions, and 5 sets. Let me tell you what is here. This is, you can become a member. Since we say we are open to the world, we're open to you. Of course, you have to like and understand what we are doing. Because some people, they, especially from the United States, they think that we are like USA, that we organize conference with 2,000 and 3,000 people, which is much. We don't do that. All our conferences are very small. Once a small conference becomes big, we chop it. We separate, we make it 2 pieces. This is one of the education conference, for example. It grows, then we're going to have something similar. So we want to have small groups between, as I said, between 25 and 50. By 25, I'm missing all the time 25. If you read the ancient Greek symposiums, one is of course by Plato, the other is by Xenophon, they determine the optimal number of people to participate in the symposium. It started, of course, with the space, but it started with 24 up to 50. And of course, they had some rules how they organized their discussion. Now, we have 6,000 academics from 150 countries that here volunteer their service to help with reviewing. I'll come back to that because this is very important for us. We have 2,000 research that come every year. And in total, over the since 95, we have more than 20,000 people that came to our events. Some people, they come again and again. Now, so as I said, you are free to join us. What we are organizing, it's the International Conference and Symposium. You can assist us, of course, in courses in Athens. That's a new thing that we have added. I can give you more information later on. We can organize autonomous summer courses. We have done that before. We can do research, if you want, about this presupposes that we have the extra funding. And of course, that's a new thing as well. A lot of people, academics around the world, they want to spend time enough to do their research. We do provide now a game without money. I want to make sure that we don't have the money to give around. We don't want to get into debt. We are doing very well. We want to keep it okay. And we don't spend money to finance research or to host visiting research. As I said, we're an association. So that's the basic activities. Now, that's a pain in the neck, which is called publication. Originally, we did not want to publish, but we were forced because we are receiving 2,000 papers per year. A lot of people say without publication, you cannot have symposiums. Actually, even the famous symposium by Plato himself that wrote this extraordinary book, it's a conference proceedings. If you read it, those that have read it, it's conference proceedings. So he selected a few of the speeches and he edited them and then he published it. So it was even 2,000 years ago, they were conference proceedings. Now, we have a number of publications. I'm not going to spend time on this, but starting 5 years ago, we have some journals. We published 15 journals, 1-5. And these journals relate very much to what we are doing here in terms of the subjects. We have a journal on history, we have a journal on Mediterranean studies. And you are more than welcome first to submit a paper. There is no cost in submitting and publishing. And second, the most important thing, is to help us with reviewing. A lot of people, they want their papers to be published fast, but very few people, they want to review papers for us. In other words, academics are lazy. They don't want to do work for others, if they want to do work for themselves. And then they complain, they say, why are you late? Because I said, you are late in reviewing, because we are the same pool of people. Now, anyway, this is get involved, as I said, become a member. This is, again, this is very important in response to a criticism. Now, since we don't really care about the specific subject that we are going to present here for 15 minutes, but we care about your views about the subject, about the discipline. It's not so important for us to have a 15 minutes presentation, but it's very important that we get active with this conference. Now, a lot of people say, one thing is, the conferences are too general. By definition, the conference has to be general. Now, if you want though, and we have done that in the past, you can take the lead if you have the credentials and organize a special panel within this conference or any other conference. So even though the conference is general, but you can create your own, what the marketeers say, niche, and have your own. We have done that with mixed results, with great success and not so great success. We have done that in the past, and some people, they take the lead and organize a session, a stream, a panel, whatever you want to call it. And of course, help with editing these papers and publish as a special issue. That's the second thing that you can do. Review some papers, I mentioned that, organize a summer course, I mentioned that. Of course, anything, because we grow according to our friends and members, everything that, anything else that you want, pending that you have the money, of course. Now, paper presentations today, I'll do the chair of the first session. Those that they ask to chair a session or our members, please try, I know it's very difficult, try to follow rules. Academics like stray cats, you cannot hear them. It's impossible. But still we have some guidelines. Please try to follow these guidelines in chairing a session, because everybody is expecting that you follow the rules that we already mentioned, and most people do. So each paper is allowed 15 minutes. There is a reason we have 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, nobody listens to you. I mean, just in ancient Athens, the rhetorics, they said, if something lasts, I'm not kidding now, lasts more than 15 minutes, people are start, you know, looking at their watch. After 30 minutes, they start yawning. So don't expect, unless they are students. If they are your students, even if they want to yawn, they don't yawn, because they have the benefit of a mark. Okay, so that's different. Here, the young people after 15 minutes. So our papers have been presented, and questions and discussions, again, this is substantial, should take place at the end. The reason is very simple. Here, you can see, even after the first session, that we were forced to use English as a language of communication. I mean, we could use ancient Greek, but it would be very difficult to communicate. Now, we don't, of course, adopt any political, social, cultural, whatever connotations might be implied by the use of the English language. It's an instrument, even though some people from languages that we organize what I'm saying, they say it's wrong. But we use it as a mode of communication. We have to find something to communicate. Those that they speak, the only language they speak is English. They are surprised when I tell them that there are other languages in the world, because they don't know. And they think English, by nature, somehow, it's the only language in the world. So people that come here, including myself, their first language is not English. Even though I have the best English accent in the world, I mean, no doubt about that. Nevertheless, there are other different actions. And these different actions are not understood by many people, and they are difficult. So that's why I say the questions at the end. People are scared when sometimes that's their first presentation meeting to have in front of an audience, now you have to ask me questions. Some people come to tell me, please, let them ask me questions outside. I don't want in front of a room to speak and ridiculate myself because my accent or my English is not as good. So the chair, please, have the questions at the end, it helps. Chairperson will use 3 minutes and 1 minute reminder. That's because we follow Socrates' suggestion. Was fed up in one of so many dialogues. And he said, I translate it for, elect a judge. I mean, because they had these discussions. Or a foreperson, or a chairperson, whatever. The Socrates was fed up. Because some people would talk forever. so you keep the length of each one's speech short. And I have the ancient Greek as well. So, and use the word metron, which is, means not only short, it gives an idea of, it should not be more than 15 minutes actually. It gives you an idea, it should be short, because that's, everybody has the opportunity to talk. For technical assistance, before the session starts, you can ask Olga, she's over there, or Kostas, so they can put in your presentation, we have a presentation, they can upload. Now, we have some what I call pedagogical events. Pedagogical events, but between me and you, it's tourism. And I don't like it very much. With the exception, of course, of the urban walk. If it's your first time to Athens, this is ours. This, we organize it. And so it's tomorrow morning. And of course, the Greek night tonight, because that helps us to continue the discussion. I don't have anything else to say. Now, just to tell you that we overbooked the first sessions of the conference, even we have not a cancellation. One of the six presenters of the first session missed the plane or something happened from Italy, and will come tomorrow after 1 o'clock to present. So this happens many times because people are coming from different regions of the world. So there is a change in the program, but we overbooked the first session. So we have here the four, five presenters, and we can start right away. And of course, at the end, we'll have the discussion. So if you have any questions, I'll be after the break, and you can ask me. I'll ask Stephen Oberham to impress us with his speech.